Help us to lay down all the stuff from this week and just spend some time with you right now, Lord, listening to you as we hear your word today. In Jesus' mighty name, amen. Amen.
Let's say thank you to Mark. We're saying thanks, Mark, because I want to say something to you. Can I share something with you? All right, brother. Mark's a friend of mine, and it's been a new friendship in the last year or so, and I thank God for him. And I want to say to Mark, Mark, I better be hearing that message that you just shared the second time next time. Meaning, do we need each other?
Yep.
Yes, we do. I'm there, and I want to hear that message during the week so I can pray for you, get on my knees for you, and know what's going on. Do we need to know that about each other?
Yeah.
We're here, and who are we here to see today? Primarily.
God.
We're here to see God. We're here to bring our stuff to God. We're here to come and worship Him, praise Him. We're here because we need Him. Anybody with me?
Yeah.
Mark, you opened it up. You're the second or third person this morning that opened it up. As you came to Jesus this morning, you laid down some stuff. Name that again. What did you lay down?
Anger, unforgiveness, bitterness, lust.
Okay. Did you hear that? Mark has come laying some stuff down. I want to know if there's anybody else. Before I say a word, I want to know if there's anybody else who's come here like Mark to chase down Jesus with some stuff. Let's go one at a time. Let's go. Yep. Say your name so everybody knows and what it is.
Larry, faithfulness, love, and some anger.
Okay. As you take that, truly lay that down at Jesus' feet and hear what He has to say to you. We may come back around to hear what He actually is saying to you. We're going to hear this morning, because it's exciting. Yes, who's next? What are you bringing? Yes, John.
I just want to try and forgive others as I've been forgiven too.
Okay.
Sometimes I don't feel like I've been forgiven.
Forgiveness is a complicated journey. You're saying three or four things in that package. One is, I want to forgive others. The others, somebody's maybe not forgiving you. Maybe it's forgiving yourself. Maybe it's understanding how much God has forgiven you. We're going to get that today, for sure. So lay that down. Give it to Jesus. He wants to hear it. Who else? Yes.
Unforgiveness? Is that the question?
No problem. The question is, as we came here this morning, Mark opened up and some other people have saying, I've come here to Dunamis Church this morning to bring to Jesus something. And what is it that you're bringing to Jesus this morning? What do you have to lay down at His feet?
My own addictions.
Addictions?
Cigarettes.
Okay.
Marijuana.
God wants to take them, doesn't He?
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
Jesus came to this earth so that you could bring them to Him.
He already did. I just invited them back.
Okay.
It's time to hear them again.
Day what?
Day
what?
Day one.
Okay, yes.
Heartbreak.
Yeah. Want to share any more? Or is that enough?
This had to do with my mother. She lives in Florida. And really rocky relationship for many, many years. And but now we're getting back to that place, and I don't want the enemy to come in and steal it, because I know he's really good at that. So we're trying to just slowly getting to a place where we talk on a regular basis again. So bringing like the heartbreak that was all in the past between us. And
why would you want to hold on to that? Why would you keep it? Why would you just let it sit in your heart and not give it to Jesus?
Defense mechanism.
Yeah. But see what happens when we give it to Jesus?
Yeah.
There's brothers and sisters here, I hope, who are praying for each person who shares whatever they share. Mm-hmm. So you pick it up, you take it to the throne of God, you pray for them, and then if God leads you to, and as He leads you to, you go to them this week. You call them, text them, go for a walk, invite them, do coffee, send them a message, send them a song, send them a prayer, contact them, and connect with them the way Jesus has connected with you. Thanks for sharing that. Another one. I saw another hand or two. Yes.
I pray for my friend smoking and marijuana. They spent a lot of money to try and quit, like $400, going to London twice, what have you, and they're still not quit. So I just pray every day that they will quit. It's a hard job to quit smoking, and the devil has got a hold of you. I know I was a big smoker, so, and I was able to quit. So I'm just hoping God will lead these other people and sister over there. I hope that God loves her enough to quit. And I think all Christians should quit smoking because it's so bad for your health, for your lungs. My wife died of lung cancer. She had a cigarette before she died, so I know. She died 20 years ago. Anyway, I just wanted to say that.
Thank you. Catch what just happened there?
Yep.
Some of you are going, yeah. I have something I got to bring to Jesus, and that's legit, and that's good. Yeah. Awesome. He's going, I'm bringing some friends to Jesus.
Yeah.
Know anybody in the New Testament about their friends to Jesus? Yeah. We might take a look here today at that. Bring your friends to Jesus, bring your stuff to Jesus. He wants it. He's here today, and we're here today to bring it. And all week long. All week long. My first acquaintance with lung cancer was my uncle. And then my grandfather. And then my other uncle. All passed away. Lost a lung, went into the next lung, lost that one. Time's out, lights out. And yeah. So it has had an impact on my family, as well as some alcoholism and some other things, and great-grandfathers and other types of situations. So there are addictions everywhere. Satan wants to trap you, and Jesus wants to free you. Amen?
Amen.
What else? Anybody else got something? You right now have come here today, and you want to bring it to Jesus. Yes? Pardon me? I missed that. Okay, can somebody repeat that for me?
Thoughts of suicide.
Thoughts of suicide? Okay. Would a couple of people surround her, what's your name?
Laura.
Laura? Let's pray. Laura, thanks for opening your heart and bringing this to Jesus.
Yep.
Let's pray. Heavenly Father, it's you and only you that brings value into our lives. God, you loved us, you redeemed us, you gave your one and only life for us, for Laura. You love her, you cherish her, you treasure her. She's precious in your sight. Her breath, her tears, her energy, her love, her life, her purpose, everything matters to you about her, and that's why you sent your son, Jesus Christ, for her. God, may those of us here breathe that kind of life into her as we mirror back in our eyes our love for her, her value to you, her value to us. May she never, ever again question that the rest of her life. And God, when the doubts come up, I pray that the enemy would be sent back into the darkness where he belongs. God, that your light would shine on her heart, that she would see arms stretched out on that cross for her, that she would see an open tomb and a resurrected Jesus in heaven praying for her and preparing a place for her so that one day she will spend eternity with him. God, in this world, it can be a mess. It can be a nightmare. It can be ugly. It can be a place that we can't wait to leave. But God, in the meantime, give her hope. Give her purpose. Give her faith. Give her a trust in you that's unshakable. And may that grow every day as we pray for her and never give up. In Jesus' name. Amen. Continue to pray for her, folks, and thank you. Those of you that are sharing what you shared about your situation and your mother and forgiveness, we're praying for you, and Jesus has heard. The pathway to day one is what we're doing. The pathway to day one is, and I want you to look at Luke chapter 8 with me. Let's go straight to God's Word. There's some thoughts I have, but let's go straight to God's Word. And if you want, you can read this with me, or you can listen, however you want. If you have a Bible in front of you, or your phone, whatever it is, iPad, computer, go to that, and let's do this together. After this, Jesus traveled about from one town and village to another, proclaiming what? Some good news of the kingdom of God. The 12 were with him. The 12 were what? Listen, he's God. Why couldn't he just do it by himself? What do you need 12 guys for? What did he pick 12 guys for? What did he add others to the team for? Why didn't he just fly solo? Because Jesus is teaching us that we need what?
Each other.
We need each other. Never forget that. Quit flying solo. Here we go. And also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases. Wait a minute. Some people came to Jesus with what? What is it? You ever come to Jesus with an evil spirit? If you have one, you need to. And who has ever had a disease? Bring it to who?
Jesus.
Bring it to Jesus. Mary, called Magdalene, from whom seven demons had come out. Verse 3. Joanna, the wife of Chuza, the manager of Herod's household, Susanna, and many others. These women were helping to support them out of their own means. While a large crowd was gathering and people were coming to who?
Jesus.
Where have we come today?
Jesus.
We've come to Jesus. We haven't come to Mark. We haven't come to Mark. We haven't come to a facility here. We have come to
Jesus.
So when you come to Jesus, he changes your life. From town after town, he told this parable. Here's the parable. A farmer went out to sow a seed. As he was scattering the seed, some fell along the path and was trampled on, and the birds ate it up. Some fell on rocky ground. When it came up, the plants withered because they had no moisture. Pause a second. I hope you're not one of these kinds of soil. Because when you come to Jesus, come tenderly, come softly, come open, come transparent, come vulnerable. And don't come with a hard heart. Don't come with that angry spirit. If you do, come and lay it before Jesus. Say, Jesus, I do. I have that hard heart. I have that anger. I have that sense of bitterness. I have that revenge. I have whatever it is. And here we go. They had no moisture. God wants to put some moisture in here today. It may start in our eyes. Other seeds fell among thorns, which grew up with it and choked the plants. I love reading God's word, don't you? Still, other seed fell on good soil and came up and yielded a crop 100 times more than was sown. When he said this, he called out, whoever has ears to hear, what? I say that to you today, whoever has ears to hear, let him hear. Turn to somebody beside you and say, do you have ears to hear? Give them an answer. Is that a yes or a no? And we move on. Thanks. Next verse. Thank you. His disciples asked him what this parable meant. He said, the knowledge of the secrets of the kingdom of God have been given to who?
You.
Again, do this to each other. You've got the secrets. Please tell each other. But to others I speak in parables, so that though seeing they may not see, though hearing they may not understand. Do you want to be here today and see? Yes or no?
Yes.
Do you want to be here today and really hear?
Yes.
Do you want to be here today and truly understand?
Yes.
Why waste the time? Why not have our eyes and hearts open wide so we can hear and see what God wants you and me to see? About what? About your personal situation. About your life. So that you're changed. So that you are what we're about to see. Because the best is yet to come. Here we go. This is the meaning of the parable. The seed is the word of God. Those come along the path are those who hear. And then the devil comes and takes it. What? He takes away the word from their hearts so that they may not believe and be saved. And Mark tells the story about the snake, and the snake shoots off in the grass and drags us with it. with our thoughts and energies and passions, and takes us completely the wrong direction. And God says, this is the way I want you to go. Let's find out what that means. Those on rocky ground are the ones who receive the word with joy when they hear it, but they have no root. They believe for a while. Aha. So that means there's people that might walk into this church. They might hear. They might hear for a while. And then what happens to the folks? You tell me.
They leave.
They come, they go. And why do they come and why do they go? Help me. What? Why does that happen?
Doubt, unbelief, rebellion.
Doubt, unbelief, rebellion?
Deception.
I'm about to tell you something that you're going to see. It's the pathway and the key. The pathway and the key is they stop doing what we're doing. They stopped bringing their mess to God and go, I'm all cleaned up. I'm good. I'm cool. I don't need this anymore. I don't need you anymore. I definitely don't need you anymore. And I don't need you. So I'm out of here because I'm cool. So Jesus says, Jesus says, for all have, Romans 3:23, for all what?
Sinners.
You are all a mess. I am a mess. And when people stop bringing their messes to God and go, I'm good, don't need them, we're going to see people who brought their stuff to God all through this chapter, and it's going to blow you away, I hope, so that you realize the people that come and went, they go, I'm good, I'm fine, I'm cool, I'm okay. Are we ever okay without Jesus? Why do we have the Adam and Eve complex? Do you know what the Adam and Eve complex is? The curse that hit Adam and Eve is they hit the earth, they go walking with Jesus, and they walked away from Jesus, started to have a chat with the enemy, and then they hid. They started hiding what? What did they hide? They hid their story about their mom. They hid their story about their lust. They hid their story about their anger. They hid their story about their wanting to maybe take their life. They hid their story about struggling to forgive. They hid it. They covered it up. They hid their story about their addiction. They stopped bringing it to God. And they kept secrets. And those secrets made them walk right out that door and not need Jesus, you, me, or anything. And you know what happened to them? Let's find out. So they believe for a while, but in the time of testing, they fall away. The seed that fell among thorns stands for those who hear. But as they go on their way, they're choked by life worries. Anybody had a worry? Anybody have a worry right this minute? Please share it with me, please. Do you have a worry? Anybody? Yes?
I have a sister who is an addict, and I worry about her safety and everything.
That's worth a worry, but it's also worth this entire church getting on our knees. Can we name her name, or would you prefer to keep it? Rachel? Let's pause, everyone, and let's pray for Rachel. Heavenly Father, Rachel's got an addiction. That addiction could take her life. But it definitely will ruin her life. It will destroy her dreams. It will destroy her capacity to love. It will take away her capacity to have a relationship with you or anyone else in a way that you created her to have. God, whatever it is that she's addicted to, is, you know, it's just replacing the need she has for you. So God, step in through your power, through your grace, through your love, and free her from this addiction. Help her to find a place and people where she can go and get healed and get love and make things right. Amen? I can't hear something and not pray for it. I can't hear a concern because it's not about me. I have no power. The only one who does is Jesus Christ to take care of her. Continue to share her word and her story everywhere you go and never stop until she's healed. Riches. Anybody want to be rich? I don't know if anybody here ever bought a lottery ticket thinking they were going to win. Did you? The big jackpot? I know some guy in Brights Grove won something years ago when he bought the Brights Grove golf course and all that kind of thing. It happens, but it's a trap.
He's still lost.
What's that?
He's still lost.
What's his name? Never mind.
Jay.
Okay. Let's pray for Jay right now. God, Jay needs you. He's got some money, but he lacks the pathway to eternity. We pray for salvation for Jay. Amen?
Amen.
Riches and pleasures. We pursue all kinds of things because we're okay. And in the meantime, we're just medicating and self-medicating the hurt and pain and loss and sorrow and sadness we feel, and the desire for meaning and hope and fulfillment and purpose that God has given us. I walked in here today, and I will not name a name, but I met a gentleman, and I asked about him, and he said to me, I'm a nobody. Is that true?
No.
Any one of you a nobody?
No.
You know what's not true about that? Is that God created you and put you here right now at this time. Nobody in the world is like you. He called you, redeemed you, chose you. He put spiritual gifts in you. He gave you a specific temperament and personality. Why? To shine the light. But I would feel like a nobody if Satan tells me I'm a mess and convinces me I'm a mess apart from Jesus. So the thing we're going to see here today as we move forward is God says, Jesus says, Paul says, I boast in my weakness. It's because I'm weak, he makes me what?
Strong.
So you don't stop being weak or pretending you're strong. It's in your strength, he makes his grace sufficient for you, in Corinthians. So we have got to stop this, I'm great. I am righteous and I am holy. Yes, you are in Christ, but you are still a mess. You are still a sinner saved by grace. And you still mess up until the day you land in where? And when he makes you like him. And when you become like Jesus. And you are perfect. Until that day, you will mess up. So let's stop hiding and pretending and faking and keeping secrets. And they do not mature. Did you catch that? Oh, I have been praying for my four kids. Daughter Jessica, son Kalen, daughter Ashley, and daughter Kylie. Jessica is in Park City, Utah. She called me this week, and I have been praying for her and for her spiritual maturity. This week, we went from conversations that are minutes, and because she's on the run, literally, but figuratively, and so on. She's just a girl that trucks and moves, and you catch her these minutes conversations on the run. This week, 3 hours. 3 hours. Because that one word back there, the verse before, mature. She is maturing and she says, Dad, I want to know where I came from. I want to know why I do what I do. I want to know who I am. Can you tell me more? And so we began the conversation and went into 3 hours of a conversation that we could have gone on for hours more. It was miraculous. I've got a son that needs Jesus. I've got a team of people praying for him. He's in Vancouver. He's an occupational therapist. Loves life, but he doesn't love Jesus. He walked away. And he hasn't come back. And he's going to come back. Because friends and family and people are not going to give up and pray for him until he walks through the gates and into the kingdom of Jesus. Amen. Where Jesus loves him and frees him and knows him. Then I've got a daughter, Ashley. Shocked. This is a funny disclosure. I haven't done this before, but here's my morning. This morning, let's go back a step. A couple days ago, out of the blue, my daughter calls me. Says, Dad, you know, I missed your call. I was on another call. She goes, where are you? She's like, you know, hey, watch it out. Where are you? Talk to me. And so I'm like, okay, sorry, I missed your call. I'm here. How's it going? What's going on? She is on her way back from North Carolina to Michigan. She and her husband are travel nurses, and they have just, because I haven't seen her since January when we moved her down, she is just moving back. I thought she might move to Dubai or California or New York or somewhere else, but she's going from North Carolina to Michigan. She says, Dad, coming home. I am like, that is like the best news I've heard in so long. When do I get to see you? She says, well, let's spend time together this weekend. Well, a couple weeks ago, I booked a friend to come out to the water and said, you know, what can I do to encourage you guys? And he said, well, I've got stepsons and kids and everything, and could we come out and jet ski and that kind of thing? So I'm like, yes. And he says, will you be there? And I'm like, yes, I'll be there. Well, when your daughter calls and you haven't seen her in 8 months, you have to call your friend and say, can I pass? Something I almost never do. But I did. Well, this morning he calls to say, are we set up? And I said, you're set up. I said, are you going to go? And he said, well, can you check the water? I run down to the water. I'm getting ready to come here to teach. I run down to the water and see, is it flat? Or is it wavy? What's it like? Is there wind? And so is it north or south wind? Well, it was a south wind. And so I run back to the phone. I'm like, it's good. It's good. Come on out. And what do you need? And so life jackets, how many you need? So get the life jackets and put them where you need them. And then gas and then oil. And then I get down to the jet ski. Well, the waves and the water had covered the wheels on the jet ski halfway up. So I dig them out because I don't want him doing it and with his family. So dig them out. And I'm just like going. It's like, how come there isn't anybody on the beach at 8 o'clock in the morning? Where is everybody? They're sleeping. And so pull it out and set him up, call him, and then there's other calls that came in and so on and so forth. Anyway, I don't know what your morning was like, but I needed Jesus this morning to be able to get that thing out, to get it set, to get him set up, because after the service here, I have the privilege of slipping over and hanging with my daughter and her husband this afternoon. So she is set. God has blessed her and her hubby with a job. Awesome. And for the next 12 weeks, they'll be here and then they'll be on to the next place as travel nurses. Then I've got another daughter who had a major medical exam, third year med school at UCF in Orlando, Florida. So what I mean is I bring this family to Jesus on a daily basis, as well as my friends. And I too bring, and as you shared, and what's your name again?
Tim.
Tim shared, he's bringing a broken heart. I bring too a broken heart to Jesus today, that I might be open and ready for new relationships in my life. Because has anybody here ever had a broken heart? You know what I'm talking about. Where your heart breaks over something. It's a loss, it's a relationship, it's a distance, it's something. It's hurt, pain, something. Let's go back. On the good seed, good soil stands those with a noble good heart who hear the word, retain it, by persevering produce a crop. We're going to continue to go right through. No one lights a lamp, or should, light a lamp and hides it in a clay jar, puts it under a bed. Instead, they put it where? On a stand. So that those who come in can see the light. Guess what? When you and I do the stand, you can see a little bit more that I wore shorts and all this kind of stuff and whatever. Knobby knees and all that good stuff. When I stand, I'm exposed. I'm not standing there covering up. When the light comes on, the light reveals what? The only thing light is going to reveal is imperfections. But then Jesus shines his light on my imperfections, and I got to be okay with that. Because I got to bring God my what? My mess. Turn to somebody and say, you're a mess. You really are. Like, and have you ever heard anybody use the H-O-T word? Go ahead and use that one now. Ready? Go. You are vomit. Now, that's used sort of like this weird endearing sort of thing that is, this. Anyway, it's bizarre, but yes. And it's got a history to it, and you can look up the history yourself because it goes back in Europe when people had, the mess hall, and anyway, whatever. But the fact is that you look at me and please everybody do this. Mark, you're a mess.
You're a mess.
Together, come on, ready, go.
Mark, you're a mess.
I would 100% agree with you. I need you. I need your prayer. I need your encouragement to be who Jesus wants me to be, and I cannot do without it. I need friends. I need family. I need Jesus every minute of the day. I need the Holy Spirit's guidance. I need God's word. I need to put myself in a place of saying, and what's your name, brother?
Rob.
Rob, I am a mess. I need your accountability in some area of my life. I don't know what it is. I don't know what you're good at. I don't know what your spiritual gifts are, but I know I do not have the gifts you have. I do not have the insight and abilities you have. You have something in you that God needs to plant in my heart and my life. That applies through the room and around the world to, as Mark said, godly people. So that those who come in can see the light. For there is nothing hidden that will not be disclosed. Get that truth of that? We try to hide, but is it really hidden?
No.
We try to pretend. We try to fake it. We try to look fantastic. We clean up. Like, wow, you really clean up well. But there's nothing hidden that will not be disclosed now or in the future. Nothing concealed that will not be known or brought out into the what?
Light.
So why not bring it out yourself?
Yeah, that's right.
There's an H word that represents that. What's that word?
Humility.
Humility. Nobody has to do this except for me. But let's practice humility right now. If you want, you don't have to, but let's go down on our knees, anybody who wants to. Okay? Hit your knees if you choose. And I'm going to pray. Okay? God, those of us on our knees are saying we don't want anything hidden. Those of us on our knees are saying we're a mess. Those of us on our knees are saying, God, you came, you saved us, you loved us, you chose us, you called us, you redeemed us, you forgive us. And God, we're down on our knees saying we need you. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Back up. Only, please never get back up. We need to stay on our knees. How often? And how long? Every day. Every day going, I'm a mess, still I'm a mess. I'm not pretending, I'm a mess. I need you and I need Jesus. Therefore, consider carefully how you listen. Whoever has been given more, whoever does not have, even what they think they have will be taken from them. So you want to pretend? Whew, it's gone. Now Jesus' mother and brothers came to see him, but they were not able to get near him because of the crowd. Even family were coming, and they were bringing their stuff. Next one. Someone told him, your mother and brothers are standing outside waiting to see you. And what's he say? What's his response? He replied, my mother and brothers are those who hear God's word and put it into practice. So God opens up the door into the family of God, past blood family, to say, your family are people who walk with Jesus. Your family are people who love Jesus. Your family are people who love you like Jesus loves you, who will listen to you and who will, James 4:16, confess your faults to one another and you will be healed. One day Jesus said to his disciples, let's go over the other side of the lake. So get in a boat and they set out. As they sailed, he fell asleep. A squall came down on the lake, so the boat was being swamped and they were in great danger. At this moment, what are they bringing to Jesus? Tell me.
Fear.
Yes. Jesus set them up, gave them an opportunity. Usually the enemy sets us up, but occasionally God sets you up for something good. When the enemy sets you up, he's taking you down. So get your eyes on Jesus, as Mark said this morning. But when God sets you up, again, same eyes on Jesus, but he's got a greater purpose. And let's see, the disciples went and woke him, saying, Master, Master, we're going to drown. He got up, rebuked the wind and the raging waters, the storm subsided, and all was calm. Because what did they do? They brought their
fear.
To who?
Jesus.
Anything. Jesus wants it all. Where's your faith, he asked his disciples. In fear and amazement, they asked one another, who is this? Like, have you ever said that? When God did a miracle in your life, like, wow, who is this? He commands even the winds and water, and they obey him. They sail to the region of Gerasenes, which is across the lake from Galilee. I love the fact that Jesus gives his geography, because every bit matters. When Jesus stepped ashore, he was met by a demon-possessed man from the town. For a long time, this man hadn't worn clothes. What did this man bring to Jesus? Tell me.
Demons.
Again, one more time here this morning, what are you bringing to Jesus? Text yourself in your phone. Today I'm bringing to Jesus. Send somebody a message. Today I brought to Jesus, and fill in the blank. Because if you're coming to Jesus empty-handed, you're going to go away empty-handed. He brought his demon-possessed man. Okay? For a long time, the man had not worn clothes or lived in a house, but had lived in the tombs. What a mess. When Jesus saw, he cried out, fell at his feet. When he saw Jesus, he cried out, fell at his feet, shouting at the top of his voice. Why don't we do that? You know, Mark, Tim, John, all of us, cry out. Cry out at the top of our lungs, Jesus. I heard a new phrase this week. It's called freaking out in the love zone. It's something David did and practiced. Job practiced. And you can practice. Freaking, the love zone means you're connected with Jesus. It means, Laura, you can completely freak out in the love zone because God hears the cry of your heart. You can tell him exactly how you feel. Freak out and share it. Blast it out. Because you're in the presence of a God who loves you unconditionally. There is nothing... You come to Jesus the way you are. You keep coming to Jesus the way you are. The reason people walk out and come and don't come back in is because they forgot. I came to Jesus as a sinner, and I'm coming back in here a sinner again. And when you come back in a sinner, you are down on your knees, and you are recognizing, I need you. God, I need you. Desperately, I need you. Let's go. What do you want with me, Jesus, Son of the Most High God? I beg you, don't torture me. This guy had no clue who his Jesus was, but he was about to find out. For Jesus had commanded the impure spirit to come out of the man. Many times it seized him, and though he was chained hand and foot, kept under guard, he had broken his chains and had been driven by the demon into solitary places. Folks, don't let the enemy fool you. Don't mess with the enemy. It's awful. God's power is greater. Amen? Jesus asked him, what's your name? Legion, he replied, because many demons had gone from him. And he begged Jesus repeatedly not to order them to go into the abyss. A large herd of pigs was feeding there in a hillside. The demons begged Jesus to let them go into the pigs, and he gave them permission. There's a lot of bacon that day. The demons came out of the man. They went into the pigs. The herd rushed down the steep bank into the lake and was drowned. When those tending the pigs saw what had happened, they ran off and reported this in the town and the countryside. Somebody's messing with our pigs. And the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out, sitting at Jesus' feet, dressed in what?
In his right mind.
If you feel you're not in your right mind, that could mean demons. It could mean some mental illness. It could mean torture. It could mean that just you're in a dark place, and you've got to get out of that place, and you've got to get help. Reach out. Okay, we're going to wrap this up. And the people went out to see what had happened. When they came to Jesus, they found the man from whom the demons had gone out sitting at Jesus' feet. Okay, sorry, I'm repeating the same one. Next verse. And those who had seen it told the people how the demon-possessed man had been cured. And we're getting to a story I want to finish with. Then the people of the region asked Jesus to leave them because they were overcome with fear. So he got into the boat and left. Can you imagine sending Jesus away, the one who is healed and done this kind of power? I'm telling you, that wouldn't have been me. I mean, I am right there. I want to see this. I want to experience it. I don't want to miss a thing. The man who the demons had gone out begged to go with him, but Jesus sent him away, saying, return home and tell how much God has done for you.
Yeah.
Folks, Mark stood this morning. You stand here today. Begin telling people what God is doing for you. Yeah. Are you doing that? When you can say, I'm a mess, then what happens? Then you can see God work. But if you stand around people going, I'm cool, I'm great, I'm wonderful, everything's fantastic, there's no evidence of the power of God in your life. Because you're good. You don't need God. You don't need believers. You're fine. It doesn't mean that I say, go find yourself sin, go find yourself an addiction, go find yourself trouble to make God glorified. No, you already have enough. If you would just be honest. There's a need you have in your life. Return home and tell God. Tell us. So he returned and told them all over town what Jesus had done. When Jesus returned, a crowd welcomed him, for they were expecting him. Now a man named Jairus, synagogue leader, fell at Jesus' feet. He said, come to my house. Let's continue to skip through. Okay, his daughter, a girl of 12, was dying. And again, he brings who? People keep bringing people to Jesus. You keep coming to Jesus with your stuff. Next. The crowds are crushing him. A woman was there who had been subject to bleeding. I'm going to end with this story. Bleeding? Lady, sorry. But guys bleed. Just happens to be a woman. How long had she been bleeding for? How many years? 12 years. All I mean to end with this today here is this. Is that when you come to Jesus, you can come to Jesus with a mess. Whatever that mess is. Whatever kind of bleeding it is. Because each of us are bleeding. We're bleeding with forgiveness. We're bleeding for our lives. We're bleeding for a mother. We're bleeding for issues in our life. We're bleeding for addictions. And who bled and died for you to stop your bleeding? Jesus did. She'd been subject. No one could heal her. Let's find out what happens. She came up behind him, touched the edge of his cloak. Immediately her bleeding. What? You got to bring your stuff to Jesus no matter what it is. Who touched me? Jesus said. When they all denied it, Peter said, Master, the people are crying and pressing against you. What do you expect? But Jesus said, somebody touched me. Have you come so close to Jesus that you know you touched him and he knows? I know that power has gone out from me. Let's finish this up. The woman, seeing that she could not go unnoticed, she comes trembling and fell at his feet. In the presence of all the people, she told why she had touched him and how she had been healed. What? Is that it? Then he said, Daughter, your faith has healed you. Go in peace. As we wrap it up today, the key, the solution, the answer, the insight to where Mark started us this morning is, if we have to believe and say to each other, even now before we go, that our mess has brought us together this morning. Isn't that the coolest thing in the world? I'm here because I'm a mess. I wouldn't be here otherwise. I'd be out skiing with my friend or golfing with my daughter or doing something else. It's our mess that brought us together. God looked down on our mess and he said, I'm sending Jesus because you desperately need Jesus. Before, when people had a mess, you know what they called for? They called for a judge. They called for a king. They called for something, and they got what they deserved, and it messed them up even worse. So Jesus goes, I look down. God looks down. He sees you and me, and he sees our mess, our struggles, our pain, our addictions, our hurt, our sorrows, our sadness, whatever it is, inside or out. And he says, I am crazy about you. I'm sending my son, Jesus Christ, to redeem you, love you, forgive you every single day the rest of your life. Amen? Amen. Let's stand and pray. Link arms across the aisle. Touch shoulders. Move to where somebody is so that you are next to a brother or sister in Christ and make a connection, please. Okay? Nobody alone. Nobody alone, because we cannot be alone. We cannot live alone. Did Jesus try to do it alone? Not a chance. We need each other. I'm coming over. Let's pray. God, thank you for Mark's word. Thank you for the songs. Thank you for the worship. Thank you for the privilege and the opportunity to glorify and honor and praise you. God, we praise you because we're a mess. And you loved us. You said, while we were yet sinners, who died for us?
Jesus
died for me. Jesus died for us. God, help us never to stop bringing our messes. Help us to stop the secret, stop the hiding, stop the pretending, and make these messes come out so your glory is and your light shines, so that Jesus shines through our lives as the one who does and is doing the miracles in us to redeem us, save us, forgive us, love us, and help us realize that we're not nobodies, that we are somebodies because we're a mess and because what Jesus is doing in that very mess. Amen?